You're listening to The Hour of the Time. I'm Pooh.
And I'm William Cooper.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I'll be in to check you in just a little while.
All right.
Good night, baby.
Good night. Bye.
Bye-bye. Ladies and gentlemen, I've been getting calls all day long. Seems Pat Shannon didn't like being corrected. But poor Pat Shannon, and let me go back and give you what this is all about. It appears that he has been on the radio attacking my character all day long because I reported that his report on the Freeman preliminary hearing was a total, absolute lie. In fact, nothing but pure bullshit from beginning to end. And apparently he was trying to call me to get me to come on the air with him. Number one, I don't do that, ever. Number two, I have my own radio broadcast. Number three, I don't have the time right now. I'm getting ready to do a conference next week, and I will be gone for quite some time. And after Mike and Sharon left us, I don't have time to do anything. In fact, my good friend Anthony J. Hilder has been trying to get me to appear as a guest on his broadcast. And I don't like to say no to Anthony, but I had to. I have been busy from dawn till dusk. I will be busy half the night tonight. We don't have time to play games with Mr. Pat Shannon because he doesn't like his report being exposed as a bunch of baloney. Not only that, but he hurt an awful lot of people. He gave an awful lot of people false hope. And they may have hope, but not the kind of hope that he was trying to give them. So let me go over his report that we read, and I cautioned you not to believe it because it was not in conformance to the habits and the previous behavior of the judicial system, so to speak, and not to go off half-cocked because it probably would turn out not to be true. And after we investigated it, and everybody else in the world investigated it, everybody who looked into Pat Shannon's report in the Freeman preliminary hearing found out that it was not true. Not true at all. Not even remotely true. But this is the report that he sent out as a press release. And I'm going to read it to you again. And then you're going to understand real quick that this is just a crock of crap. He said, on Wednesday, July 17th, and he put this out, I believe, on July the 22nd. Here's what he said. On Wednesday, July 17th, Freeman Leroy Schweitzer sat as Chief Justice Schweitzer in a Billings, Montana courtroom and directed the first common law grand jury to be heard in 135 years in America. Their purpose was to pass judgment over a lower jurisdiction. And it wasn't true, folks. There was no common law grand jury conducted on July 17th in Billings, Montana, or in fact, anywhere in Montana, in 135 years or any other time, except maybe before 135 years ago. One of the things wrong with that, ladies and gentlemen, is you never conduct a grand jury consisting only and solely of all of those charged with a crime. Wouldn't you just love that if you got charged with a crime, they let you conduct a grand jury and be the only grand jury member to decide whether you're going to be indicted for that crime? I don't think so. And in fact, it did not happen. Pat Shannon just flat lied. And he goes on, with apparent deference, Federal District Judge James Burns appeared on the bench without his black robe in the United States Courthouse to direct the proceedings. Well, we haven't been able to find out whether he wore a robe or not, so we don't know whether that's true. He goes on, after an introductory statement, he yielded to the Superior Court in the charge of Chief Justice Leroy Schweitzer, who then alerted the prosecution attorneys to not object because I will only overrule you. The five other justices were Freeman, Stuart Waterhouse, Ross Landers, Ellen Ward, Rod Skirdall, and Emmett Clark. They flashed a smile of pride each time Judge Burns referred to their old friend Leroy as Chief Justice Schweitzer. In a complete turnaround, Burns recognized the authenticity of the common law court while stating that he was disappointed in the American public for falling into an ignorance and slumber, allowing the nation to reach the point that it has. Chief Justice Schweitzer then took over the proceedings and presented the facts to the board of other five justices, all the accused. This common law venue is what they've been asking for since long before any confrontation with the FBI and other law enforcement. Amazingly, it was granted. Not. Chief Justice Schweitzer cited the National Constitution and that of Montana and dozens of sections from the U.S. Titles 26 and 28, supplemental U.S. codes to prove the judicial authority of this court to act. Well, if Chief Justice Schweitzer really knew anything about the law, he certainly would not have cited Title 26. Oh, boy. The justices conferred for a short time before issuing the order of the Superior Court to abort the forthcoming trial of the Freemen by the federal judiciary and to release them from custody. The 22 American nationals have now been acquitted of all charges. Absolute bullshit, ladies and gentlemen. Pat Shannon should hang his head in shame. And Pat, listen to me very carefully. You can get on every radio show across this country. You can drag my name through the mud. You can call me everything in the book and everybody else who has proven that your story is wrong. It is still wrong, Pat. You have still lied that this is nothing but a bunch of BS, and you know it. And so does everybody else who has taken the time to investigate it. So why don't you stop your whining and learn how to do good, legitimate reporting? And when you sent it to this broadcast, Pat, when you put this out and made sure that everybody across the country got it, you should have known that of all people, William Cooper would investigate what you said, because I never put anything on this broadcast that is not investigated, period. Now, I did read it before we checked into it, but I also cautioned my radio audience that it probably was not true, and to be very careful about believing what you reported. And then we checked it out, and by golly, I was right. It is not true. It was a preliminary hearing. Listen to what he says now. Listen to what he says. The 22 American nationals have now been acquitted of all charges. Unless someone from the federal side of this legal fracas can quickly find something unlawful about this proceeding, this common law grand jury decision will prevail. Well, it didn't prevail because there was no common law grand jury and there was no proceeding and no decision, and you cannot have a grand jury of any kind that consists only of those who are accused of the crime. Or, in fact, you can't have a grand jury with anybody sitting on it who is accused of the crime that they're trying to find whether they should prosecute or not. That's the biggest bunch of baloney babble that that anybody could have come up with. He says, today, Monday the 22nd, the written order of this court was served upon the Yellowstone County Sheriff, the clerk of the county, court reporter, and the aforementioned District Judge James Burns. We have checked with all of these people. Nothing was served upon them whatsoever. Said the Freeman expect to be released in a matter of days. Well, supposedly, ladies and gentlemen, that took place on July 17th. Supposedly, this decision was served on July the 22nd. It is now August the 14th, which is quite a bit more than a matter of days, and the Freemen are still in jail, ladies and gentlemen, awaiting trial after having gone through their preliminary hearing. So, whenever you hear something like that happening, ladies and gentlemen, don't call me, because, you know, somebody is calling me names 24 hours a day, every day of every week, of every month, of every year. You notice that Pat Shannon never called me anything. until I exposed this as being a lie, a blatant lie, barefaced lie. So I'm going to tell you again, Pat, you can call me names until the moon turns purple. You can jump up and down and wear robes on Halloween evening and go look for the great pumpkin. This is still a lie. This will always be a lie, and nothing in the world is going to change it. And you are still persona non grata with your reports on this broadcast because of this lie. You see, once somebody tries to perpetrate something like this on us, we never ever, in a million years, ever listen to them or give them credibility again. Now, if you were to, over a long period of time, prove that you had changed your modus operandi and had become, indeed, a good, objective reporter, then we might change our mind about that. But it's going to take a lot of convincing. So I know your heart is bleeding. If you react anything like you did this time to our exposure, and I have seen some of the letters, by the way, dripping with venom and hatred that you have sent to the other people who also investigated your report and exposed it as a lie. And you need to be admitted to a mental institution, Mr. Pat Shannon, because you're a sick man. Very, very sick. And for you and the listening audience, ladies and gentlemen, when you hear somebody doing something like that, don't call me because I'm not in the least bit interested. If it upsets you, call that radio show and put them on the spot. Make them prove everything that they're saying. Make them document it, all of it, including the names that they call me. They can't, won't, and never could. Now, I've got a report that is disturbing. This, unfortunately, is a true report, and I'll get to it right after this.
Come on, let's cruise your cat. Nothing to lose, so come on, let's cruise your cat. Nothing to lose, so come on, let's cruise your cat. Nothing to lose, so come on, hey baby, come on. Come on, let's cruise your cat.
I forgot to tell you, ladies and gentlemen, that I should have some word tomorrow night about where we're going. I told you that we would be simulcasting next week. We will not. The new station will be earlier, an earlier broadcast, and we will run reruns on WWCR. We will be live on the new frequency. We will be running reruns on WWCR. So that's the way that's going to work. And now for the bad news. on July 10th, ladies and gentlemen, 1996, agents of the Federal Bureau of Investigation, armed with a search warrant and dressed in full flak jackets, blocked roads and sealed off a residential area. They stormed and sealed off school buildings at LaSalle University and the World Christian Church, a Christian university located in Mandeville, Louisiana. Employees were lined up and had their pictures taken without the benefit of knowing why. They were instructed to provide personal information again without the benefit of knowing why. In addition, the university's summer student workers, 14 and 15 years of age, were also detained for questioning. Employees were denied privileges such as entering buildings, receiving and placing outgoing telephone calls, as subpoenas were handed out. What was the crime that was committed, ladies and gentlemen? There was not any crime. When asked what was the offense, the FBI simply stated that the information was sealed. When the media came and asked the same question, they were told the same thing, that this was sealed. No charges had been filed. No employee has been arrested. No director of the church or university has been arrested. And no crime has been reported. There was no reason given for the raid. Truckloads of documents were taken as employees and neighbors looked on with amazement. Subsequently, bank accounts were seized. The school's endowment funds, which were set aside for the protection of students, were also seized. Again, no reason was given. No charges were filed and no hearing was made. Not at any time has any director, employee, or individual associated with the university ever been told anything other than the records are sealed and that no information will be given as to what has happened. Employees of the church and university were questioned, and when the answers did not satisfy the agents, they were called liars. They were also harassed, belittled, and told they would be charged with crimes themselves. Ministers that live in church housing were told that the Federal Bureau of Investigation could kick them out of their homes. Again, no charges have been filed, and no arrests have been made. When questioned about this, John Fleming with the Federal Bureau of Investigation simply stated that there was an investigation and that it had been ongoing for a year. Again, no reason for this investigation has ever been forthcoming. The questions are, in a free society, can the United States government, in the form of the Federal Bureau of Investigation or anyone else, come in, remove employees out of buildings, take all records, seize bank accounts? Can they harass employees when answers given to questions asked are not satisfactory to those asking the questions? Can they do this without any charges or indictments being brought against the organization or individual employee? Well, ladies and gentlemen, apparently in America today, the answer is yes, because on July 10th, 11th, and 12th, at the World Christian Church and LaSalle University, this is exactly what has occurred. What can be done about it? Well, they have brought in attorneys, they filed for release of the funds, and their employees continue to be harassed by the FBI. To date, five employees and a minister have resigned. People are feeling intimidated. They've been told by these agents that they should quit their jobs. They should quit? Why? And that they should testify against the university and the church. Against them for what? The employees, ladies and gentlemen, have stood strong and have been encouraged to simply tell the truth. Our employees are honest, hardworking, family-oriented people who assist in providing religious education and training to over 5,000 students worldwide, says Thomas J. Kirk, who is the minister at the World Christian Church. LaSalle University. Actually, that's more than the actual figure is cut off here, ladies and gentlemen. I see 5,000 students worldwide, but it's obvious to me that the first number is missing. So it's probably many more than that. LaSalle University is a religious university offering quality education programs to students worldwide. The facilities in Mandevelle occupy over two blocks and employ over 100 employees. They also have over 1,000 faculty members worldwide. The university continues to provide religious education and training as both a theological seminary and a religious school. So why is this happening to these people? Well, nobody really knows. All they know is that they fought to keep religious education from being secularly licensed. They stood strong on the issue against federal funding of abortions. They stood strong against the passing out of condoms in high schools. They stood strong against daycare centers being federally licensed. They stood strong with the Christian Coalition on all of those issues. They have also fought against government regulation, and they have won their battles in the courts. With those victories, they have infuriated more and more government officials on not only a state, but as you can see, on the federal level also. Are their students satisfied? Well, like any institution, ladies and gentlemen, LaSalle University has had complaints, but those complaints have been subject to mediation and arbitration, and the university has tried to resolve them. With over 15,000 students last year, the university had less than 15 complaints. 15 complaints out of 15,000 students. Now, I bet you could compare that with any institution in the country, and it would probably come out on the low end. I would bet that they beat Harvard, Yale, the University of Arizona, the University of California, at Los Angeles. I bet you they beat every major university in this country with just 15 complaints out of over 15,000 students in 1 year. Allegedly, ladies and gentlemen, the basis for this seizure and investigation is that the university's accrediting body is part of the World Christian Church. The Council on Post-Secondary Christian Education, or COPCE, is part of the World Christian Church. Students know this coming into the university. They set up a church education program and a church accreditation program. Students must take religious education as part of their training, and all courses are written from a religious perspective. Now, they believe that the government is not satisfied with this. They want to secularize and tax all institutions. What they really want to do is control all institutions, cut out all religious teachings, and make sure that Marxist socialism is the only thing that's taught. The people at LaSalle believe that the government intends to close LaSalle University, to seize its assets and to use those assets for their own secular purposes. So what's going to be next? Maybe federally funded abortions and passing out condoms in all schools? Well, if they have their way, I'll tell you that's exactly what's going to happen. You see, government wants to regulate all education, including religious education, and in fact, they want to do away with religious education, especially Christian, especially Islamic, and especially fundamental Judaism. LaSalle University, ladies and gentlemen, believes in the freedom to make a choice between secular education and Christian education, and so do I, and I know so do most of you. They fought against government licensing of Christian institutions. You can't have a religious institution which is controlled by government. And if the government is really serious about their baloney lie about the separation of church and state, then what are they doing sticking their nose in the business of a religious institution? They're not sacrificing people on an altar at midnight. So, they're asking that we all examine these issues and take issue with the federal government on this issue. Those of you who can should visit the university. You should interview the employees, the staff, and the students. And you better hurry before they all get scared and leave. You're invited. You're invited, ladies and gentlemen, to totally examine the Christian education that LaSalle University provides. And then maybe you'll help them shine the light upon this violation of the rights of free worship and education, which is something that we all should be concerned about. You see, this could explode at any time. This could turn into another Waco. It's possible, ladies and gentlemen. We can't stand by silently as the government tries to infringe upon all of our rights. Do you realize that the Bill of Rights is almost totally gone? They have almost, not quite, but almost done away with the protection of almost every right that Americans have traditionally held. Why is it that they don't want us to religiously worship in the manner of our choice, at the altar of our choice, with the literature of our choice? Why is that? Anybody got any answers to that? I know. And I've told you many, many times. But you see, you need to know. And not because I told you, you need to know because you have figured it out for yourself, as I've always advised you to do. Listen to everyone. Read everything. Believe nothing unless you can prove it. You see, we used to get all upset when these things happened in the Soviet Union. And we used to be taught that they only happened in places like the Soviet Union, communist countries, or in Nazi Germany. Jackbooted thugs, Nazi stormtrooper jackbooted thugs, at will, without cause, and without public hearing, seize assets, records, shut down schools, terrorize employees and students. You see, you only think you're living in the America that you remember. You're not. This is no longer America. It's something else. We haven't quite figured out what it is yet, but it's more akin to Nazi Germany. It is more akin to the old Soviet Union. The people and organizations that we used to respect and admire and look up to and never fear in the form of law enforcement organizations that used to have as their motto to protect and to serve, used to feel comfortable when you saw a police car on your block or a policeman walking down the street coming toward you, but not anymore. It instills abject terror in everyone. And I'm talking about people who've never committed crimes in their life, wouldn't even think about it, are terrified of the police today. So, if you'd like to help, you can contact Thomas J. Kirk, who's the minister of the World Christian Church. And his number is 504-845-7809. That's 504-845-7809. Call him, ask him how you can help, and then help. I mean, really help. We'll be back after this short pause, ladies and gentlemen, and then we'll take your calls. So, don't go away. Thank you. Opportunity to listen to Craig and hear what he believes and why he does what he does. It is to our great advantage that we have people like Craig and Swiss America Trading who are willing to face the dangers and the public pressures and the media condemnations and attacks and engage in the controversy because they sponsor programs like the Hour of the Time. And I can tell you that over the years, Craig has lost an awful lot of potential business from those who, of course, take great issue with the principles and ideals of the Founding Fathers, which we propound over the air. I've given you all the reasons over the years why you should have some real money. It is so important, ladies and gentlemen, that you protect yourselves, your family, and what you have by getting your hands on some real money. And I mean real money. Not that phony baloney stuff that you've got in your pocket. You can't even use that as note paper. It's worthless. It's covered with ink. You can't even write a shopping list on it without getting all confused because the writing's jumbled up with that other stuff that's on there that nobody understands because it doesn't make sense and none of it's true. Like Federal Reserve. Most Americans really believe that's part of the government. And note, if you look up in a legal dictionary the definition of a note, you'll find that the Federal Reserve note is not a note at all. And then when you try to determine what that piece of paper is worth, well, if you go by paper prices, being that it's covered with ink, you've inflated it beyond its true value because paper is only worth something if it's blank, hasn't been used yet, ladies and gentlemen. And I think we all know that. So you can't tell from paper prices. It might be worth something as a collector's item to people who collect worthless phony counterfeit paper that has been pawned off as money over the years. And there you might be approaching some kind of value. But if you really want to find out what the value is, first you have to look at the definition of money. And forget about what it says in the law. Look at it in a legal dictionary, the definition of money. Look at the definition of money held throughout the ages, and then go to the law and see what the definition of money is. Money of account of the United States of America. And then look at a dollar and see what a dollar really is. A dollar is a unit of measurement. It is not money, ladies and gentlemen, any more than a quart is milk. So if this makes you curious, after this conference next week, when I get back, I'm going to play Stephen Jacobson's tape on money. And if you've never heard it before, it's going to blow your mind. And if you have heard it before, you need to hear it again. It's the best education on money and economics that I have ever heard or seen in my entire life. And he deserves great recognition for that. And I and others have tried to give it to him. So in the meantime, if you want to investigate what it means to hold a silver dollar or a gold coin in your hand, call Swiss America Trading. Ask them for the latest newsletter. Thank them for sponsoring the Hour of the Time. You'll get red carpet treatment, ladies and gentlemen. I guarantee it. 1-800-289-2646. That's 1-800-289-2646. Do it now. We'll take your calls. 1-800-289-2646. Call Swiss America Trading right now. We're going to take your calls on this broadcast. 520-333-4578, ladies and gentlemen. 520-333-4578. Oh, boy. You just got a preview of what we're going to take you out with there. 520-333-4578 is the number. And we'll be taking your calls for the remainder of the hour and discuss whatever it is that's on your minds. 520-333-4578. For all those of you who never knew the number or those of you who have forgotten it, good evening. You're on the air.
Yeah, all right, Bill.
Yes.
Yeah, are we talking about anything tonight?
What do you want to talk about?
All right. I got a problem.
Have you been listening to the broadcast?
Yes. Why?
Well, I just wondered. You said, are we talking about anything tonight?
Yeah, well, I didn't know if you were sticking to a theme or anything. All right, anyway, I live up here in Pennsylvania. This is Carl from Pennsylvania. Okay?
Yeah.
Now, I'm with a militia, you know. Like you always said, you pick your close friends and associates you've known for a long time, and then, you know, go out and train, and just be responsible and read and educate, right?
Yeah.
Well, there was a robbery in my neighborhood and down the street from me, and because of that, the police think I'm involved. And coincidentally, I have a back problem, so I have to stay up late at night. And believe it or not, I have seen a red vehicle that's been suspicious. Now, it might be a red herring, it might be nothing, or it might be something. And now I can't talk to them. I can't talk to anybody. I wanted to talk to the man who got robbed and say, you know, I heard you got robbed. That's pretty bad and all that. But my parents, they flipped out on me and practically threw me out of the house. They told me just to shut up, keep quiet, and go watch TV.
What's the point of all this?
I don't know what to do. Sorry? I'd like to make, you know, friends with the police, friends with the neighbors.
Whoa. That's, you're asking the impossible. If you weren't friends with them already and they think you stole something from somebody, it's not likely that you're going to make friends with anybody.
I'm friends with a lot of them. It's just now the rumors are flying at the local donut shops, and I don't know what to do about it. It really puts me in a fix.
Well, what do you want me to do about it? I can't do anything about it.
Well, I'm just asking your opinion.
I don't know. Unless I investigated the whole, you might have stole it. I don't know. Or you might be totally innocent. But just to call up and ask me to give an opinion on something I know nothing about on the air, I can't do that.
Just do what my parents said and shut up and be quiet and don't do anything?
I have no idea. I just told you. I don't know the circumstances. I don't know if you're innocent or guilty. I don't know why they suspect you. I don't know anything.
I told you why they suspected me. I'm with the militia.
No, that's not why they suspect you.
Oh, yeah, that's what they said?
No, that has nothing to do with robbery.
I know that, you know that, but because I'm the boy down the street with the militia, they automatically suspected me because guns were stolen, jewelry and guns. And they figured, oh, guns, him. You know, that's the mentality there is up here.
Well, you may be right, but like I said, I don't know. You're asking me to make a judgment about something I have not investigated, don't know anything about.
Well, I'm just asking you, if you were in a similar situation, would you just forget about it, or would you go?
I don't forget about anything, but I'm not in the situation, and I would have to wait until I was in it and find out what was going on and who was doing the accusing and why, and then I would determine what I was going to do from that.
All right, I just wondered. I just wondered whether I should just shut up or go out and try to do this on my own.
You know, you have to make that decision yourself.
I will.
Okay.
All right, I thought you could be some help. All right, but...
Well, I can never be help on anything that I don't know anything about. Nobody can.
I explained it to you. All right, thanks anyway.
Oh, boy. Yeah, you explained it to me. That's your version of what's happening. I haven't heard anybody else's version. I still don't know what's happening. I don't take anybody's word for anything. And if you've been listening to this broadcast for very long, you should know that by now. I don't take anybody's word for anything. I listen to everybody. I read everything I can. I don't believe anything. And I don't understand why you haven't figured that out yet. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hi, Bill. It's Michael calling. I'd like to read you something quickly. In modern society, both politics and economics conspire to create a culture inimical to the preservation of an important social domain reserved for the religious. An increasingly permissive culture, exploiting the principle of the separation of church and state, squeezes out the religious factor, but without substituting it for any secular categorical imperatives, thereby transforming the inner moral code into a vacuum. Now that's the big new Brzezinski talking.
Yeah, and I don't know, what are you quoting out of?
That's from Out of Control, Global Turmoil on the Eve of the 21st Century.
Oh, yeah. And have you read his other works that he wrote, calling for a Marxist, socialist government?
No, I haven't. No, I know your feelings on this man, but in this book, he certainly presents himself as anything but Marxist, unless I'm not reading between the lines, and that his idea of a new world order is disorder, because he tries to discredit the idea of a new world order and sees nothing but the new world disorder. Now, that, of course, could be their order, you know, Ordo ad Deo here.
No, I've read Out of Control. I've also read his previous works. I'm trying to think of the one where he propounds Marxism and socialism is the answer to the world's problems.
Might be the technotronic area or the birth and death of communism, which he calls the grand failure.
Yeah, he calls that the grand failure. They call socialism the success. You see, the clash between capitalism and communism was supposed to produce a socialist world.
Correct.
That's the synthesis between the two. And that's what he calls for. And it is the, I could never remember the exact title of that. What was the name of it?
America's Role in the Technotronic Era.
That's it. Yeah, that's the one where he talks about the world becoming a socialist and becoming socialism and answering all the problems of the world. Out of Control is his look at what's happening now, and it's his warning to those who want to have this socialist world that they're losing it.
Right.
And that nobody really has control of what's happening, and if somebody doesn't get control quick, it's going to erupt into something that nobody knows what it's going to be.
That's a good synopsis, Bill. I think you hit it on the head.
Well, that's, you know, I've got all of those books. I've read them. I've studied them. Zbigniew Brzezinski was the national security advisor for President Carter.
Right.
And he was preaching socialism then. And we all know that Carter's a socialist, so what's the surprise there?
Right. Well, what are you going to do about it? And what should I do? You know, that last call was something else. I'm sorry you had to waste your time. Your patience was beyond the call of duty. I understand the young lad's concern, but really, what are you going to do? I mean,
well, there's nothing I can do. I couldn't even determine what was really going on from one side of the story.
He can't be listening to you too well, or he would have heard your message of think for yourself.
Well, he sounded distraught, so I don't want to get on his case. He sounded distraught and upset, and you know, but who knows what's happening?
Sure.
Thanks for calling, Michael.
Good night.
Good night. And that was a great quote. By the way, 520-333-4578 is the number. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hey, Bill, it's Anthony. Let me turn my radio down. Off now.
Yes.
You remember you and I had a conversation the other night off air? Anyway, I just want to call and I can just ask you a question because you said you're going to play some money tapes after you're back from vacation.
Yes.
You ever heard of the Monetary Realist Society from St. Louis?
No.
No. Have you ever heard of Merrill Jenkins?
Doesn't ring a bell. I may have heard of him, but it doesn't ring a bell.
Well, he wrote a whole bunch of books basically saying the same thing you were saying about how the dollar was defined as a mass of silver or an equivalent amount of gold. He invented a lot of machines to examine the authenticity of gold and silver coins, and after they did away with that, he used logic and reason to figure out what was going on, and by logic he deducted that there was some kind of invisible government out there using this monetary system. And one of his students, he died in 79, and one of his students, his name is Dave Wilbur, and I ran into him here, and he gave me all the Monetary Realist Society books, and they're really good and everything.
Well, great.
So, I just want to tell you that in case you want to become familiar with it.
Okay, thank you.
Good evening.
Appreciate it. 520-333-4578. Yeah, the young man was right. Good evening, you're on the air.
Yeah, Bill, I heard on Gordon Liddy one time, he's talking about a program called the Director of Civilian Marksmanship, where you can get a M1 Garand from the Army. Have you ever heard of that program, and what's that?
Yeah, that's the program that recently somebody called in to Bo Greitz, said that he wanted to join a militia, but he didn't know which militia to join. He didn't know if there was any around in his area, and asked Greitz if he would give him a recommendation. Greitz told him to call the FBI, and the FBI would tell him which militia to join, and to get his to call this organization that you just brought up, and get his M1 from them.
That's some kind of a...
It's a government program that was started a long time ago to allow civilian marksmen and hunters to be able to take advantage of surplus military weapons that were going to be scrapped or junked or destroyed. And many of them were brand new, and there was nothing wrong with them. And for many years, it served a useful function. Now I think it serves a function is to find out who's got guns.
Well, you think they take names down? And
I know they take names down.
Really? I was thinking about that was a good way to get an M1. Are there any other ways to get an M1 besides that?
Yeah, go buy one.
Okay.
Got them all over the place. Every gun show. Get the shotgun news. Get the gun list. There's another good one out, too. I forgot the name of it that is real slick. I forgot the name of it. Anyway.
Oh, that's okay. So, one more question. I remember on a previous show, this was a while back.
You got to talk louder. You barely got a level on my meter here.
Okay. Can you hear me now?
Yeah, but talk louder.
Okay.
Be forceful.
On a previous show, you stated that in military intelligence, the only way you get into military intelligence is if you were a member of the Masonic Lodge or a Mormon. Now, yeah. Did I hear that right?
I said one of the fraternal orders.
Yeah.
And most of the intelligence community over the years has been recruited from Brigham Young University, and because of that reason... they're really heavy on the Mormon side.
Yeah.
That's true. It's admitted by the Mormon Church.
But not all of the military intelligence people are like Mormons or, you know, part of the fraternal orders.
Yes, they are.
All of them are.
Yes, at the important levels, they certainly are.
But the important levels.
If I had not, and I got to tell you, if I had not gone to a couple of DMLA meetings and couldn't find it on the form that you check the organizations that you belong to, so I checked Freemason, I would have never been in Naval Intelligence.
That's the question I was going to ask. I was going to say, how the heck did you get in?
I've told the story 5,000 times. You must be a new listener.
Yeah. Well, I'm a recent listener.
Well, I was a DMLA when I was 13 years old, I think. 13 or 14, I forget which. A friend of mine asked me if I'd like to come to a meeting with him, and I went, and pretty soon I found I was saying yes, I want to be a member, and then I was initiated and into the first degree, and then my father was transferred. He was an Air Force officer, and I never went to another meeting in my whole life. And when I had to apply for top secret Q clearance, when I was at St. Pat Fleet, I checked that I was a Freemason because there was no DMLA on there, and DMLA was the young men's organization of Freemasonry.
What?
And you had to answer truthfully if you had ever belonged to any organizations. So I checked Freemason. The next thing I know, I was in the Office of Naval Intelligence.
What are those implications?
Actually, it took place before I was at St. Pat Fleet. It took place... I forget, but I had to fill out 5,000 forms. That's an exaggeration, but anybody who's ever gone through a security clearance knows you get a big stack of forms, you got to fill them out, and what is what?
What are the implications for this country when you have the top echelons of our military intelligence belonging to organizations that are essentially Luciferian?
Well, if you can't answer that question...
Rhetorical question, I know.
Anything that I would tell you would be a moot point.
That's why, you know,
why do you think we're going down the tubes?
That's why I was going to say that.
Our government is in control, is being controlled by these people.
That's why the country's going to hell. It's controlled by Luciferians. Okay, Bill. Thanks a lot.
Mm-hmm. 520-333-4543 is the number. Good evening. You're on the air. 520-333-4543. Good evening. You're on the air.
Yeah, Bill.
Yes.
Yeah, I'm not sure. I just got home. I didn't know if you're on a specific subject tonight or not. I just had a couple of comments on your thing on Mars the other night about the life on Mars.
Oh, by the way, you just reminded me. A professor at the University of Arizona, or Arizona State University, actually, is what it is, down in Phoenix, has announced that he believes there's life on Europa.
Yeah, that's exactly what I was going to call and tell you, because you mentioned that they were going to bring that up next, and I heard that the next
year. Yeah, well, it's already come true. I was right again.
Yeah, and then back on the Olympic bombing thing, I was watching that the first few minutes it happened, and they were interviewing one of the band members, and who said that.
I saw that, too. What they're saying now is totally different from what the truth is.
Yeah, what
the truth is that... Pardon?
What, someone else had found the bomb.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, it was a music director.
Yeah, or some man or something else.
Yeah. One of the guys involved with the music and sound production.
Yeah, in a paper bag, and then later on it was in a military knapsack.
Yeah.
Okay, I just thought I'd mention that, and I'll let you get back to another call.
Okay.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you. 520-333-4543. Is the number. Oh, yes, they can't tell the truth about anything, ladies and gentlemen. Good evening, you're on the air.
Oh, good evening, Bill. Your little story, how you started this thing out, the World Christian Church, seemed to strike a nerve with me. I don't know, nobody else seemed to connect with it. I don't know why I haven't heard that before.
I don't know why you haven't either.
Yeah, everybody.
Maybe nobody cares.
Everybody should be up in arms about it. This is fundamental religious freedom. Were they served with a warrant? I forget whether you said they were served or not.
I don't have it in front of me now, and I forget too.
Well, a warrant.
I think they did have a warrant.
Would have to have probable cause. They can't seal it if they have to show probable cause. So
no, you're wrong. They sealed it on the Branch Davidians when they did Waco, too. It was sealed. You couldn't touch it.
Where does the authority come from? I find no authority in the law.
Well, I didn't say there was any authority. I said they did it.
Well, that's what
there's no authority for them to kill the Branch Davidians, either, was there?
Well, no, I agree.
For a $200 tax because they suspected they had a machine gun.
This appears to be a prima facie crime, the way you describe it.
Well, it is a crime.
Well, why
most of what they do today is a crime.
If we've been so desensitized,
let me ask you something.
A crime when somebody.
Why weren't you down at Waco with me trying to stop what was going on?
Well, I was the only one.
Wait a minute! You haven't answered my question. Why weren't you down at Waco with me trying to stop what was going on with me and Linda Thompson? Pardon?
I didn't have the money to travel there. I would have liked to have.
You just answered your own question, my friend. Why isn't anybody doing anything? You want to know why anybody isn't doing anything? Because it isn't worth anything to you. You answered your own question. You didn't have any money. I didn't have any money either. Neither did Linda Thompson. Neither did the other ragtag group of people who went down to Waco to try to stop what happened down there. Good evening. You're on the air.
Good evening, Mr. William. Your last thing. What was the name of that? I live in Louisiana.
Uh-huh.
And I have heard absolutely nothing about what's going on in Mandeville, which is 3 miles away from me.
Yeah, well, it hasn't been on the news, has it?
No, it hasn't. Thomas Kirk, did you say?
Thomas J. Kirk. He's the minister of the World Christian Church.
Let me get that phone number, because I'm going there tomorrow. I'm going to get a group.
504-845-7809.
845-7809.
Yes.
I'm going to get a group of teachers from the university in which I teach to go over there with us while we're on break and see what's going on.
Good.
Thank you very much.
Go see Mr. Kirk. 520-333-4578. Good evening. You're on the air.
Yes, I'd like to see about getting your magazine.
Well, I don't have a magazine, and I don't talk to people who don't turn off the radio. Good evening. You're on the air.
How you doing, Mr. Cooper?
Yes.
You had a caller a few minutes ago, and you were talking about your experiences in naval intelligence.
Yes.
Okay. Now, you were talking about a conspiracy involving Mormon Church and Masonic and
I was not. We didn't mention the word conspiracy.
Okay, we won't say conspiracy. You're saying the higher echelons of intelligence community are dominated by people from those groups?
Yes.
Okay, I was calling, I'm an intelligence battalion in the Army right now, listed. And one thing that we noticed is that we send our Spanish language to Brigham Young University.
That's exactly what I've been trying to tell you.
Now, I know some of the people that went, you know, over to the university, some people also did some time in other countries, and it was supposedly for the improvement of their language skills.
Well,
what is the connection? Like, at what level does this take over? I mean, I'm familiar with a lot of people.
In the Mormon Church, you have to be a missionary.
Right.
Which means you go to a foreign country, or you go someplace, and you try to convert people to Mormonism.
Right. And
you learn the language, and you learn the customs, and you make friends with the people. You come back and go to Brigham Young University. You graduate, the CIA, the ONI, Army G2, they all recruit you, and you go back to the same countries as an intelligence operative.
Right.
You know the drill. You just said you're in an organization.
Right. Well, I'm a member of the organization, and I know a lot of lower-level officers. I'm enlisted myself.
Mm-hmm.
Never really experienced this to be...
To be what?
In the way that you were saying. I mean,
I didn't say anything.
Brigham Young was their fluency from Spanish at that university is because they sent some...
Listen to me.
Yes, sir.
The intelligence community for many years has recruited very heavily from Brigham Young University. That's a fact.
Okay.
The Mormon Church has admitted it over and over again. What is your beef with that?
Well, I was wondering, what's the reason for that connection?
Well, you're going to have to ask the people who are doing the recruiting. Ask the CIA. The whole intelligence community is top-heavy with Mormons. That's a fact. It's been admitted by the Mormon Church, by Brigham Young University, by the Central Intelligence Agency, by everybody else. It's no secret. We're out of time.
What would you get embittered?
We're out of time. I have nothing left. Good night, folks, and God bless you all.